Hello, welcome to the Law of the Gosh podcast. I'd like to start off by mentioning a film that came out in 2006 from Iran, which is a movie that was directed by Jafar Panahi, which tells the story of women trying to get into soccer stadiums in Tehran. And this was the first time I had heard of the problem that women in Iran cannot enter stadiums to watch soccer matches and other sporting events. And then in 2016, during the Rio Olympics, I saw a woman protesting. Her name is Daria Safai, and she was holding a banner said, "Let Iranian women enter their stadiums." And she was asked to take down the sign and escorted out of the Olympic stadium. And I tried to find some videos of Daria, but I saw that a lot of her videos were in languages any other than English. But recently I found that she did have a couple of videos in English. So I thought I might get in touch with her and see if I could have a talk with her. And I was very fortunate enough to have her accept. And she's with me here now. Thank you for coming on, Daria.
The pleasure. Hi, I'm glad to be on your program today.
Thank you. So I'd really like to start from knowing more about your background before we get into your activism, so people can be familiar with who you are.
Sure.
So from the beginning, you're from Iran originally, right? What was it like growing up in Iran in the time you were there?
As you know, I'm born in Iran and I'm grown up in Iran. So until my 25th year, I was in Iran, and I am grown up in a system of systematically discrimination against women. And of course, it remarks the places that you find that it's very difficult to live in a society that the law of the country bans you from your rights and makes a second-class citizen from you as a woman. And the systematically discrimination, it began really early in Iran for women. And it was, for me, for the first time, was when I was like 6 years old on the first day of school. And at that moment, I realized what it means being discriminated without really knowing what it means, the discrimination word. And it was like the first day of school, I wanted to go to the school, and my mother came to me and gave me a sort of uniform, which was really dark, ugly, without any form. And she gave me the last piece of a cloth, and it was like a headscarf that it was closed in front of it to hide your neck and your hair. And
this is in Iran, it's called the chador, right?
Yeah, it is a magnae, but the chador is the long one. This one is shorter until the under your breast. And with the uniform and the headscarf, special headscarf, which called magnae, we should go to the school. A child of six could not participate in the school without having that discriminatory uniform. And you know, when I wear it, the thing that it makes me upset was that I saw our neighbor next door had also a boy who was the same age as mine. And when he came with the same clothes as the day before, I knew that my life is changing, but the life of him stays still the same. Those things continued and the school, when you wanted to laugh, then you were mentioned to control yourself as a girl, because a good girl doesn't do that loudly. And every day they try to bring us up in the situation that you learn. If your hair has been seen by a man, then you go to the hell and you will burn without an end. So endlessly burning in the hell. Those those indoctrination, the way that they wanted us to grow up as a girl was really harmful and painful for a girl of 6 years, 9 years, 10 years old. And it was like you were banned from riding a bicycle at very early ages, like 11, 12 years old. You were banned to swim in the Caspian Sea when it was really hot in the summer and you went with a family and friends there. But still the boys and the men could go and enjoy the water and swimming. So it was like humiliating. And I know very well that when I was a child, I wanted to be a boy because I knew that I don't like my gender. I didn't know that I don't have any problem with my gender. What I want is just freedom and being equal and having the same right to enjoy my life. But when I grew up, then I knew what the problem was. And I started my actions, my activism against the sort of discriminations.
And all that kind of religious conservatism, did your parents believe in that firmly?
No, my parents were not supporting it and were against it because they believe in equality between men and women. And that was really the chance that I get to know other world and like lots of other Iranian, because they know what they are putting the people under pressure to obey the religious law. It is not something that lives between the people, because you can have a lot of Iranian religious people who just want to have Islam as a religion, but not using the laws of the Sharia for turning the country. This is the difference. So believing or choosing the Sharia law for turning the country like Islamic Republic of Iran is doing nowadays.
And how drastic was the change in 1979 during the Iranian Revolution before and after?
Oh, it was really very huge difference. It was like before revolution of 79, the life of Iranian people were in a good way of having better economically chances to progress in industrial or lots of other ways. And Iran was a pro-Western country. Like the king of Iran was trying to make a better life for every Iranian, and it was busy, especially for women. Women of Iran, they were on a good way toward equality. So at the last years before revolution, they could study whatever they wanted. They could be pilots or other jobs that which were not possible before. And there were a lot on the universities. Also, we had the female ministers that showed enough that they, the way on changing, it was busy in a very good way. But after the revolution of 79, a lot of things were changed and suddenly changed, and especially in the life of the women. As you know, almost one month after the revolution was in February, and on 8 March 79, less than a month after the revolution, a lot of women and men came to the streets of Iran to protest against the obligatory compulsory hijab, which the government and the regime wanted for the Iranian women. So they came out to show that they are against the obligatory hijab and the dressing code. But it was too late. It was like the clerics, they asked that it is not more a choice, but they should, the women should cover themselves when they come to the streets. And this was despite what Iranian wanted. This is not at all about the culture of Iranian people, but this is something which the country, the regime obliged people to obey. And those things were not only on the dressing code on the women, but also goes deeply through every law of the Islamic Republic of Iran toward the women. Like, for example, after the revolution, with the under the Sharia law, every woman should have a male guardian, the women cannot go out of the home or cannot go study or work or even go abroad or having a trip without the permission of their male guardian. And this male guardian under law is the father, and after the marriage is the husband of the woman. Of course, as you know, a lots of Iranian men doesn't use that power and that law to limit it, the woman, but there are still the law, discriminatory laws which men can use and have the, make the problems for women. And also, a woman cannot divorce easily. There are very special cases that woman can ask the divorce, or having four wives are something which is legally accepted. Although Iranian people doesn't do such things because it's not accepted between the people, but in the law, it is something that they can do. A lot of discriminatory laws which makes the women the second class citizen, there are numerous, they are countless. And this is how the Iranian women are almost 40 years, for 38 years, they are living and they are fighting against it. And they are protesting against it. But it is something very difficult to change. As you know, the Islamic Republic of Iran is based on the Sharia law.
So, and I also understand, although people have pointed out to me, the Parliament of Iran has female members in it, but those female members of government, one, are forced to wear chador, the black complete veil from head down, and also, even if they're a member of government, they can't travel outside the country without permission from a male.
Mm-hmm. That is a very good question. You know, those women are really decorative, because, as you know, even the election in Iran, even for men, it's not a free election. It means that they cannot choose really between the candidates which are freely supposed to be chosen. All of the candidates are chosen by a guardian council, which is made of six clerics, which use the Sharia law to choosing the people, choosing the candidates, and only those candidates can be chosen through people vote. So, as you know, those women, those decorated women who should wear the dressing code of Islamic laws, they cannot be the women who care about the women's right, although they are chosen between the women who are chosen from the Khamenei, the supreme leader, the first person of the country, and they cannot really help the woman going for what against the Sharia law, against for what they are really willing to have, and this is equality. Those women doesn't care about the equality, and that is the problem of women of Iran.
Right. So people talk about elections in Iran for parliament. But as you were saying, to even run to be a member of parliament, there's a council that has six clerics and six jurists, I believe. So it's 12 in total. And that's called the Guardian Council. And they have to approve you before you're even allowed to run to potentially become a part of parliament. And then those people have to have a history of having in some way celebrated the supreme leader and Islam to some degree, and so religious minorities can't run for parliament, and they're filtered between their allegiance to the supreme leader. And then even if you reach the presidency, the president is not really the leader is the supreme leader, and he's not chosen in a democratic way by the public. He's chosen by another small committee that's the assembly of experts. So there's a lot of different groups that are above the parliament and above the presidency. And even if you want to be a part of parliament, they filter that. So when we talk about democracy in Iran, it's not really the same as when we talk in other countries. And I think that nuance is lost on a lot of people outside of the Middle East.
Yeah, that's right. What you're saying is exactly right, because we are talking about democracy when the people are choosing something. But as you told, even the religious minority cannot take part of being elected. And also a woman cannot be a president. Like you have told, it is chosen from before through all those elections, which is under the control of Supreme Leader Khamenei. So those shows that Iran doesn't have the free election. Something that it is based on a religion cannot be free. Something that it is based only on one religion cannot be the choice of all of the people of the country. Because as you know, in Iran, we have a lot of other religion that they are they cannot take part of being in the power, and also women are the second class citizens. So those things shows enough that the election in Iran is not like we have we think about it, what it is outside the country. And Rouhani has never been chosen in a free election. It has been chosen to send between the people who Khamenei has gave the has accepted as a candidate.
And in the 90s, you were studying in university in Tehran still. And I read that you also started to participate in protests while you were there before you left Iran, correct?
That's right. When it was 1999, and as a student of dentistry and as a woman, we saw how unfair is the situation for the people, for the people who think not as government and the regime, for women and for religious minorities and for a lot of other people. That was the reason that on a protest, on a very big manifestation during 3 or 4 days in Tehran, we went together to ask for freedom, to ask that to tell them that we cannot bear the dictatorship of religious totalitarian regime no more. And that was one of the best days of my life. And it was the moment that for the first time after the revolution of 79, a lot of people, hundreds of thousands of people on the streets of Iran were shouting that we don't want to bear that situation no more. And we want to have a free country with a real democracy. And unfortunately, it was suppressed very soon, because that was the moment that the Supreme Leader Khamenei at that moment saw if he doesn't react, so the regime is in danger. And that was the moment that he gave the order to Hassan Rouhani, which is now the president. At that moment, he was not the president, but the national security, the president of the national security. And he gave the order to suppress the manifestation of the people on the streets of Iran. And that was the moment that really all the dreams that we have cheered for, the days that we thought the change is close, was still shut down.
But I keep hearing in the international news that Rouhani is so progressive and he's changing the country for a better. This is what I constantly hear about him.
This is what it is really funny. I mean, it is also sad to hear that. The Rouhani is the one who has brought the obligatory of hijab, the idea of obligatory of dressing codes for women for the first time in Iran. And after a while, in 1999, when we were on the students, we were on the streets asking for freedom, he was the one who oppressed our manifestation as students, as people who were asking for freedom. And even nowadays, further, we are going to talk about the ban of the women in the stadiums of Iran. The government who for the first time didn't sell to the tickets for the entering to a stadium to women were the government of President Rouhani. The things that in the time of President Rouhani has gone worse for women, we can count it, as I explain you, in the time of the government of Rouhani, there are quotes that are imposed in the university for women, that it makes less students for women in the universities of Iran. Women in the universities were like 76% before Rouhani came, and he bring a limitation to the universities. And now, after 4 years of his governing, women are only 47%, because they thought there are a lot of students, the female students on the university, and we should limit it. And that was also in the time of Rouhani. As I tell you that in the time of President Rouhani, the job market for women are only 11 till 12%. And the government didn't help in no way for making it more. Then we see that it's not a sort of progressive person. But the West world want to believe that he is progressive, because in the time of President Rouhani, there is nuclear deal which is signed, which is very important thing, of course, and we are glad for it. But they forget that the one who made all those crises about the nuclear deal was the supreme leader, Ali Khamenei, which himself gave the order to Rouhani that now you should end it up, because economically we cannot continue no more. The people forget that it was not without the will of Khamenei what Rouhani has signed. And this is what is it is about, that they think that he is a progressive one. Of course, still we can say there are worse than Rouhani in the regime, but Rouhani is not one of the progressive ones.
So the United States and other international nations had to paint a better picture of Rouhani to kind of facilitate the nuclear deal. And he might be progressive compared to Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, maybe, but certainly not progressive socially as in the way you think it would be better for women in Iran.
It depends how you look at it. I mean, I'm not for none of them, because all of them are working in a discriminatory system and are against equality for men and women. But still, for the example that you gave about Ahmadinejad is the one who was talking about why cannot the women enter the soccer stadiums. He was the one who wanted to open the doors of the soccer stadiums to the women. But if you compare Ahmadinejad with Rouhani, which even took the right of women to entering the volleyball stadium, because it was possible for women until 4 years ago to go to the volleyball stadiums, then you say, we cannot say one is better than the other. There are still, all of them are looking at each other in the way that they are looking at women and their equality. And the thing is that the world knows Rouhani as a better president, because with the West world and with the nuclear deal, he was the one who signed it. But we should not forget, it was not signed without the permission of Khamenei, who made this crisis. And that is what we sometimes forget about Rouhani. For the rest, the way that they look at the women and participation in the society is not really different from each other. They believe in what the Sharia laws believes in, and that is not equality. This is the women has another rights than men, and that's what they believe, all of them.
So I'd like to get to your activism, but I kind of would like to get a little bit more of your story. So when, after those protests in the late 90s, did you move, I think, to Belgium, correct?
Yeah, that's right. Yes.
So did you have to leave? Was it a necessity, or was it for economic reasons? What led to that?
Oh, no, it was not for economic reason. After the manifestation of 1999, I was arrested, and they arrested me and they put me in jail, and a very little cell of 2 meter on 2 meter, and investigations, daily investigations for the activities that we have done before it.
How long were you in jail for?
for 24 days. And they made me free on a very expensive bail. And after the freedom, I contacted my husband, which were also hidden because he risked to be arrested as well. And we decided to go out of the country. And at that moment, it was really difficult because we couldn't go legally out. But after a lot of times that my husband tried to go out of the country, we came to the Turkey. And at that moment, we thought that everything goes for a good side. But it was not. And my husband was arrested in Turkey. And secret service of Turkey has arrested my husband because they wanted to change him with another political prisoner of Turkey in Iran. And that was the moment that I contacted everyone that I knew to ask help because it was really dangerous. And that was the moment that Belgium has accepted to give us 2 visas and we came to Belgium. And that's the reason that I am really grateful because Belgium has saved our lives.
So your husband was released from Turkish imprisonment.
Yes.
And then you both went together to Belgium?
Yes, we came together to Belgium and we began our life here in Belgium. It was 2000.
In the videos I was searching for you, there's a great many videos of you on TV debating people. I think I've seen you debate in French, in German. How many languages do you speak?
Yeah, this is I'm talking French, as you know, and Dutch, and also English. Like I'm trying to talk and Persian.
That's quite amazing because I even see you debate in French with political figures, I believe. So I can't understand those videos myself. They're not subtitled, but I was quite impressed seeing these various videos of you around Europe.
Yes, that's right. Because the things that we are debating for is what we are confronted with nowadays in West countries, in America, in Europe. And the thing is that even in our daily life here in Europe, we see women who are discriminated and women who are not counted equal as men. Even we think that we are, all of us, we are equal under law, and that's right. But still, we see a lot of women in some of the communities are discriminated. And this is what we should pay attention, because all of the prosperities, all of our success in the history is thanks to some of the values and norms that we have earned in the years. And the equality between men and women are one of the most important things that we have earned, and we should keep it. And that's the reason that a lot of times I have had different debates with the politicians and with the people, because, as you know, there are some of the politicians of Europe who goes to Islamic Republic of Iran, and they cover their head without thinking about that what they are doing is just ignoring the fight of Iranian women who fighting against this obligatory hijab such a 38 years and who are daily arrested because they have their headscarf which is not which doesn't completely cover their head. So that's what they should give enough attention, and they don't do it. And if you bend for how the clerics in Iran, they are dictating. So how do you want to defend our Western values? How can you help us to progressing our country here? If you bend, if you just do accept such a thing, a lot of things, they are against our norms and values, and they are accepting it. That was the reason that I have been debating the president of the Senate of Belgium last summer.
I also saw an Al Jazeera video where you were in a debate with 2 other women, and the subject was that the United Nations had approved that Europe had people in businesses in Europe had the right to say to the people working for them that they could not show any religious or political symbols at all. So it was an equal, you know, ban to, you can't show, you know, your political symbols or your religious symbols at work. So it didn't discriminate against any particular political affiliation or religion. In that debate, there was a Muslim woman in hijab. There was a non-Muslim woman who I think was a lawyer of sorts. And there was you. And I noticed that the non-Muslim European woman was on the side of allowing the hijab. So I was wondering, is this something you confront a lot when, for example, if you're talking with non-Muslim people about a female politician going to Iran and they cover their hair, maybe they say, oh, that's good because they're conforming to the culture and it's respectful. Or the woman you were in that debate on Al Jazeera, does this happen to you a lot where you are trying to explain that certain things are acts of oppressive of women? They're not just cultural norms that should be respected by the West, because I find this happens to a lot of the woman fighting against religious patriarchy in many ways, that it's so foreign to women in the West that they don't know exactly how to approach it, and they're trying to be respectful, but at the end of the day they end up simply defending misogynistic acts.
That's right. It comes too much for me. Actually, the problem is they discuss headscarf, they discuss the hijab, they discuss the freedom of choice of hijab without discussing that hijab and headscarf doesn't know any freedom for women. And this is not something that a woman chooses freely. This is something religious. And in religion, people doesn't talk about their rights. People talk about their duties. This is what I'm asking attention for when we are talking about the freedom of choice of a cloth, like burkini, the special clothes that you can go to swimming, the hijab dressing code to go and swimming. And also when you're talking about headscarf, don't talk about freedom of choice without talking the philosophy and ideology behind it. You cannot compare a headscarf with white socks. You cannot compare a headscarf with other sort of clothes, because there is a philosophy behind it. And this philosophy and ideology doesn't believe in the equality of men and women. The moment that the woman except to cover their head, this is the moment that she wants to protect herself against the sort of lusty eyes of men. This is the philosophy which from begin, it is against this equality. It means that a woman is weak and a man is strong. That's why a woman should cover herself to avoid being in trouble. And that is the reason that I'm talking about, without talking about that philosophy behind hijab, we cannot defending the choice of a headscarf, even if we want to think that this is the choice, because something which is dictated in a religion, it cannot be a choice. It cannot be what you are choosing freely. It is an obligation and your duty in this religion. And that is what I'm asking really to be discussed more and more, because this is our debates with which can shows us the right way for equality, which can show and help us. How can we be good for equality of women and men? How can we help our women emancipating in place of putting them in a situation that they think the only thing that their identity is shown is their religion and is their covering the head? This is a pity situation for us as feminist people in the way of equality between men and women, because as you know, the headscarf and hijab And the philosophy behind it doesn't believe in equality. And that's why they cover their heads. Even if they say, but in the West countries, we are equal, we enjoy our equality. This is not thanks to what hijab is for. This is not thanks to the Sharia law. This is thanks to the secularism, the making it apart, the religion and the government. That's what we should keep. Not propagating for hijab and headscarf without seeing what the harm it can make for the women in the future.
Recently on Twitter, there was a trending topic that was principally trending in Pakistan and in Asia. But I think the elements of what I saw of the trend can apply to people everywhere. And I have seen how they apply to people, whether it's Muslim women in the West or in the Middle East or in Asia. And I saw many, because I went through dozens and dozens and dozens of these tweets and I shared some of them, but there was certain themes going on. So many people were talking about how the hijab is their key to Jannah. It's their key to heaven. Already implying that with the headscarf that women will get into heaven, implying that if they don't wear it, they'll go to hell. Or they were saying that, well, it protects you like a piece of candy is protected and you don't want to get eaten like an open candy that will be eaten by ants, or a diamond is protected, or a pearl is protected by the oyster. So already saying you're an object that needs protection. And also there was a lot of talk about how it dignifies women, or it's that their duty or it's their honor depends on the hijab, or that the hijab is a necessity to imply chastity for future marriage and other things like this. So when constantly these things are reinforced by not just men but women as well, I saw many women also pushing these ideas forward. So it's pushed on both from men in society and from mothers on their daughters. It's not just that there are countries like Saudi Arabia or Iran where the hijab or something like the hijab, which could be the chador or the abaya or something like that, that makes it compulsory. But also there's a push, there's a pressure, there's a sense of duty instigated, and then there's a fear, a religious fear pushed on children from very young to wear it. And in that sense, it's very hard to talk about freedom of choice.
This is a very good question. You know, I am living for 17 years in Belgium, and my job is being a dentist. So I have a lot of experience with a lot of my patients who are from this community, and I lived with them for such a 15 years in Belgium, and I know to which percent is it really a choice, and where is the limit. This is not about a choice. If in the countries like Islamic Republic of Iran or Saudi Arabia, the law makes it difficult for women to choose, okay, you think that we have this freedom in West countries, but we forget the social pressure. The social pressure is something very important that we ignore, and we cannot ignore it. Because we think a lot of women that we see, like we see on medias like Linda Sarsour, they talk always about the freedom of choice. This is the choice of those women. But we never hear the women who didn't choose for it. And they are imprisoned with this sort of clothes and mentality because they are sitting at home. Those people, those women are a lot of my patients, and they talked to me about their problems, their routine problems. And like I see a lot of girls of 6-7 years old, totally covered because they are just born girls. And this is happening here in Europe. How can we talk about the choice? I see the patients of me who are talking about how they should share their husband with another woman in the same house in Europe. Those women are not heard. there are a lot of young women who wants to work even with a scarf, but their brothers doesn't let them work. But those are not hurt. You know why aren't they hurt? Because they cannot communicate in the society. They cannot come out. Even they don't have social medias to talk about their problems. And they don't, more important, they don't dare to talk about their problems.
They don't do any of that, the social media, or they're outspoken because of the pressures from the family and community, correct?
Yes, that's right. Because of the pressure of family and community and the social pressure of their community, we ignore it. This is very important. I have had a lots of cases because I go to the schools in Europe, in Belgium, and I talk with the children, our future, about the equality of men and women. There are a lots of girls who come after my testimony to me, and they say they cannot appreciate me enough for bringing up this issue. This is very important for them, but they cannot talk even in the class because their brother is also in the same class. You know, this pressure is something very important, and I want the world to pay attention on it. We only hear the woman who thinks that they have chosen for the covering their head. And we ignore and forget the social pressure from the community on these people. These women are a lot, and we should be the voice of them. We should help them coming out in our society in place of pushing them and helping religious extremism to help them sitting at home. The philosophy behind this hijab is something that limits a woman. A hijab is made to protect a woman against a male. And this is the reason that they have found a better protection against the man, and that is keeping a woman at home. This is the best solution for protecting her against the man. If you accept that a woman is weak and should be protected against a strong man, then that's what it happens. They keep them even at home. And unfortunately, I should say, this is not more a problem only in Islamic Republic of Iran or Saudi Arabia or Afghanistan. This is nowadays a problem here in Europe and here in the West countries.
I also find that if, for example, in European society, or if it was American society or Canada as such, you find that the most outspoken feminists and women who would agree with you ideologically, they will say they also believe firmly in the equality of women. They do a lot of activism on the subject, and they'll find every minute, small point of discrimination they can find in society. However, when it comes to Muslim women or women in hijab, and the women you interact with in your job or that you might find around who cannot be outspoken, when those stories are a little bit spoken out, they don't get the support of Western feminists. Is this, what do you think this is due to? Do you think it's a discrimination of lower expectations? It's a fear of being called racist? Because I think it's essential that they, because these women are a minority within a minority, and they need extra help, but they're given the opposite. It's actually the women like Linda Sarsour who are the most fundamentalist and conservative about the religion. They are propped up and pushed forward.
Unfortunately, yes, this is also my experience, and I have written once an update in Wall Street Journal about how, unfortunately, some of the feminists in Europe and in West countries, they are supporting the things that it's not okay for the equality, but they are totally forgetting the women who are asking for help. And this is a sort of ignoring their problems. This is a sort of, oh yeah, we don't have a time to talk about that. Or this is a sort of feeling that the equality is only for Western women, and the other women who has cultural problems, then we can use the relativism, the cultural relativism, and think about their rights in another way. That's what is happening nowadays. As I can give you an example, some months ago, a girl, which is a champion of chess games in Iran, her name is Dorsa Derakhshani. She has chosen to make a game of chess without the headscarf, abroad of Iran, out of Iran, and she didn't wear the scarf. At that moment, the Federation of Islamic Republic of Iran, they expelled her from the national team, and she didn't deserve it. But you didn't hear any voice of those feminists who thinks that they are for equality when it goes about choosing to not to wear their headscarf. This is sometimes I feel that this is a very pity situation, because if you are for the freedom of the choice, even I am very critic about why they don't criticize the ideology and philosophy behind hijab. But if you think that you are for the choice of the woman, why are you closing your eyes on the on this sort of discrimination when it goes about women who doesn't want to wear the headscarf, but they are obliged to wear it? And that's what it happens daily inside Islamic Republic of Iran and outside in West countries, and they are ignoring it. And I hope that once they accept that those women are the women who can help not only the women toward the prosperity, being equal and progress, but also help our countries, help the whole world to defending itself against the sort of ideology and philosophy that is the enemy of the whole world. That's what we should just try to help those women, because the equality is the most important thing that we can find in the West values.
So I'd like to get to your activism, and you're the founder of the group Let Iranian Women Enter Their Stadiums. I believe that to choose and to talk about letting Iranian women enter their stadiums, that's only one problem Iranian women face. And I think you may use that maybe as an example of a larger problem, correct?
Yeah, that's right. This is, as you name it, this is a very small piece of all the rest, but it can be a symbol of all the rest. I have an idol in my life, and I look there at activism of Rosa Parks, which when she was convinced that the seat in the bus is her seat and it's not only for other colors, then she just did something that it is very important, and she sit on that chair until she made it realize for the bigger problem, and this is apartheid. In Islamic Republic of Iran, we have that sort of gender apartheid. And this problem is a very big problem, which we fight against it very difficultly. But with this way, the Iranian women show the whole world that they are busy with that fight. And it's very good if they have the support of the world, like a lot of good reactions of the world shows that they have the support, but there are still a lot of big problems even outside Islamic Republic of Iran supporting that sort of demands of Iranian women. So this is a way that we have found to show the world that Iranian women want their seats back, wants their places in the society back, and they want to gain their rights and equal rights.
One thing that stood out to me about the name is that you named it Let Iranian Women Enter Their Stadiums, not just stadiums. So is that it's theirs as well.
That's right, because this is their public places. You cannot tell that the women are second-class citizens. You cannot ban them from their basic rights and tell them that this is because they are born women. This is cannot be bared, and this is what we are against, this is the place of Iranian women. When they had the right to enter the volleyball stadiums 4 years ago, they were one third of the Azadi Stadium with the capacity of 12,000 people. The Iranian women show that they don't have cultural problem. Also, the Iranian men, they don't have cultural problem. The West world and politics like this of FIFA, the International Federation of Football, and FIVB, the International Federation of Volleyball, wants to talk always about the cultural paradigms, the cultural problems. But they don't have any cultural problems. The reason is, until 4 years ago, there were almost 4,000 women in those stadiums, and they were cheering for the national team together with the men, and there were no problems. And that's why I'm really, this makes me very unhappy when I see how the FIVB and FIFA react to those sort of suppression of Iranian women.
So Iranian women aren't allowed into their stadiums, but FIFA doesn't have a problem with letting the teams play, but they have a problem with you coming to the matches holding that sign. Now they say there's a rule that you're not allowed to hold up political signs. However, that sign is something that they should agree with, right? That you're pointing out a discrimination against women that FIFA supposedly opposes, or the Olympics as well as FIFA hold that same position, that they oppose discrimination based on gender, religion, race, or what have you, but they kick you out. Isn't that contradictory?
Of course. The problem is, this is written in the statute of FIFA, FIVB, and also Olympic Committee, that the games cannot be held in a stadium which any kind of discrimination is inside this stadium. The only thing that this positive message of us asking is just have respect for your own statue. This is what the banner asks. Iranian women are excluded from those beauty of sport and sport games. And this is not something to close the eyes on it. And the reason that they are against my banner, they know it very well. It is not because this is something political. Because the message, the positive message against discrimination is not at all political. It is about human rights. And the thing that they are doing, unfortunately, is something political, because they come to me and they say, you can keep your banner somewhere else, but not in front of the camera. And the reason is that Islamic Republic of Iran and the Federation has asked us not to let this banner inside a camera. This is really unfortunate to see how the world of FIVB and FIFA and Olympic Committee, which are for equality, are turning the back to Iranian women and their problems. And in place of choosing the side of Iranian women, they choose the side of oppressors. They collaborate to oppressors. This is really sad. And I am sure that in the history, the sign of this sort of oppression and suppression will talk a lot about how they react, and they didn't help Iranian women. As you know, years ago, the Olympic Committee has expelled South Africa from the international community of the sport world, because they said that in the South Africa there is apartheid on base of races, and this is not acceptable. If we ask the same thing for gender apartheid, then this is too much asked, because they are busy the whole time about the politics and they don't pay attention to the basic rights of Iranian women, which are waiting behind the closed doors, which are doing a lot to go inside the stadium. Even they are disguising themselves in boys. They paint their faces not to be seen that they are girls. They risk to be arrested. And a lot of time they are still arrested, but still they are trying to go inside the football and volleyball and basketball stadiums. But they are closing the eyes to sport federation and organizations. And this is what it is really sad to see. And I hope that they soon realize the Iranian women deserve the same rights like all of the women of the world. The women in Iran are the same. They want to be the same. They're fighting against this discrimination. And one day they will gain. What better than stay together with these women in place of collaborating the oppressors of Islamic Republic of Iran?
In that film from over a decade ago now, Offside by Jafar Panahi, about these Iranian women who cover their heads and try to dress like a man, paint their faces to try to slip in past any guards who might notice that they might be women. What I really loved about the film is that it showed how the women were just so excited to see any glimpse of the game and to even hear that there was cheering. They might have a goal, that they're not just trying to get in just to be antagonistic, but that they have a passion just like any man to watch these games.
That's right. You know, when was my first experience of celebrating our victory with men and women inside Iran? That was the day that I knew that I want to be in a stadium. There was at 1997, the games were preparing the World Football World Championship in 1998 in France. And at that moment, Iran was playing against, the soccer team of Iran was playing against Australia. And we were the lost team until the last minutes. And the last minutes, with gaining a goal, a point, we can go to the World Championship of 98. At that moment, we were at home looking at TV, men and women, because we cannot go to the stadium and watch it. Still, the game was in Iran, but we couldn't enter the stadiums. But after the winning, the celebration was big. We went to the street and the people of the street game, they went to the bigger street and we were all together, men and women, dancing, celebrating, and even the morale police, which are always there to oppress the Iranian women if they are laughing or dancing or listening to music, then they were not there because they were in the traffic, they couldn't get there. And that moment of celebrating with your co-patriots, being together and celebrating your victory, it was a huge, nice experience that I was decided to make it true, because I knew that this is also my right to be with other co-patriots and cheering for my country. And that's why after some years, I thought, oh, when I go to the stadium abroad, outside Iran, I can have this banner as a symbol of all of those women who cannot enjoy this victory inside Iran.
And I believe last month you were in Italy doing another protest for let Iranian women into their stadiums. And you were again both kicked out and they cut up your sign?
Yeah, that's right. Unfortunately, they were really aggressively and brutally busy to tear this banner. And they were like, that was the police of Italy. But unfortunately, it was like they are turned to the police of Islamic Republic of Iran. And they were like working for them. And it is so unfortunate to see that it is a really positive message, which we try to bring it in a really peaceful and beautiful way. We participate the game, cheering for the national team. We are not at all disturbing the population. This is what they are saying. The whole time they are saying power to you. This is really nice message. And unfortunately, the Italian police has taken me out and teared my banner, but they cannot make it to the pieces the message which is behind it. This message is so powerful that it can find its way. And you know, fortunately, the days after that happening, that incident, a lots of medias in Italy, they were against that sort of aggressivity in the stadium, and they have written a lots of good things for me and the campaign. And they said there are a lot of hate messages which are bared without any problems. Why only the positive message, which are asking for participation of everyone in the beauty of sport, should has been thrown up? And that was really the thing that they're supporting. And because of that, I have been also on Rai TV of Italy, and lots of people supported me, and I was really thankful. And Iranian women, which needs the help of the world to just be the voice of other Iranian women who want to show the world that they want to enjoy the victory of the sport.
Do you get a lot of backlash? Do you get a hate mail from the Iranian community, Middle Eastern community, perhaps even Western community, who think to bring up these issues might be an act of discrimination against Iranian minorities? Do you get that kind of backlash?
The most messages that I have received after that were the positive messages and thanks messages from all sort of people, of the people of Iran and also the people of Europe, Italy, and all around the world. Like after the game of Olympic Games in Rio, in Brasilia, was the same. But of course, between all those messages, there are also messages which criticize, and they talk about, yes, this is the sport is not place for political issues. But of course, they don't pay attention that this is not at all about politics. And the sport world, they know enough about that this is about human rights. And the reason that they say, just don't bring it in front of the camera, go wherever you want in the stadium, is that this is not a political message. And for the rest, I have a lots of good comments and messages which appreciating the things that we are doing, because for changing the things, you should act. You cannot do it if you don't talk about it, if you don't make the issue worldwide known. And that's what we should do, and we continue to do, because the public opinion that will finally make FIVB and FIFA and Olympic Committee to react for this inclusivity of Iranian women.
I notice also when you go to do these protests with your signs, you also have sometimes on yourself, or you're holding up the flag of Iran, but I notice it's the older pre-revolution flag with the lion and the sun, not with the religious symbol in the middle. Why do you use the pre-revolution flag?
Yeah, that's right. This is a flag of 1,000 years old, and this is the flag of Persia. So this is what we have had before that the totalitarian regime decide for us what is our sign. The lion and the sun, they are the sign that more than 3,000 years have been the sign of Persia. So a totalitarian regime cannot change it in an ideologically sign and say that this is the flag of you from now on. This is we cannot accept an ideologically sign on our flag, especially when this ideology is the one who deprives women and religious minorities from their rights, who doesn't let people who thinks other than the way that they are thinking religiously, they put them in prison. We cannot accept the violation of human rights, which are nowadays inside Iran in prisons, only because a journalist or a citizen has criticizing the Islamic Republic of Iran. That's why I cannot accept to put back my flag of country and to accept an ideologically totalitary sign of Islamic Republic of Iran.
What is your opinion on the politics internationally between the West, particularly the United States, maybe, or also Europe, towards Iran? Because during the time of Obama, he improved relations with Iran, but under the guise that he especially wanted to kind of rein in control of their nuclear program and released a certain quantity of funds that they had frozen outside the country that Iran could access. But now you have Trump going to Saudi Arabia, and although he was antagonistic towards Saudi Arabia during the election cycle, he went to Iran, I'm sorry, to Saudi Arabia, and he spoke as allies with them, but then spoke about Iran as the main terrorist nation in the world. Do you lean towards one approach is better than the other? Where is your opinion on how those international politics should be run?
For me, the most important thing is that now that we have the nuclear deal, which was very important, we should not close our eyes on the violation of human rights in the region. Because as you know, we as Western countries cannot be happy without ending that sort of religious problems, religious fights in the region of Middle East. If we don't know what we want to make from our future in the whole world and in the region, so we will lose the whole thing. And that's very important to focus ourselves on the human rights in the region as something very important to change the whole situation. Because as about Iran, I can guarantee that there is a lot of potentially way to change the country in a very in the way that we make more power to secular forces. But unfortunately, when we don't defend the human rights in the way that it should be in the region, those secular forces, those people who can change the history in the region, will lose. And that's what I don't see that it's happening today in the world. I don't see that West countries focusing themselves in the right way against the violation of human rights there. How can we think that it will ever change that situation in the region without helping the forces? We cannot decide in place of people. We cannot make decisions in place of the people. But when they are moving, when they are making a great movement like Green Movement in 2009, we cannot leave them alone. We cannot be just say we don't take part. We can help them, and that's what we didn't do. And this is also the reason that the region is going day after day worse. The only thing that the political world of a Western country they can do is just not closing their eyes on the violation of women's rights and human rights inside those countries in Middle East, because this is really important to avoid all the future problems. As you know, 38 years ago, that was the first Islamic state in the whole world which came to the life, and that was in Islamic Republic of Iran. After 38 years, nowadays, it is so vaster than only Iran. But the only thing that we should keep in mind is Iran has a big of potential changing. And this is what we should help those people working their job, those supporting morally those secular forces to be more powerful to change the history of Iran and the whole region.
Suppose tomorrow that Iranian women were let into stadiums and that fight had been won, would you give up or would you take on a new battle for women in Iran?
Of course you cannot give up when you know that we are still second class citizen inside Iran. Because this is not the only problem. This is just you try to attack one and other sort of discrimination, hoping that one day all of that situation will fall down and the women are the same and equal persons as a man. This, when as you know, the life of Iranian women has a lots of other limitations. If you look at the that Iranian women cannot sing solo, they cannot participate a concert when even for playing an instrument. So they know there are a lots of things to attack after a while. And you know, the goal is just being equal in one or other way that you can ask that equality. We will continue to ask it, like millions of women inside the country and outside the country, which are trying to have the same rights.
So I know you don't bring up the subject specifically of religion too much, but a lot of people in the West create either a full connection or a total disconnection. A lot of Muslims in the West who are especially very conservative, anytime a problem in the Middle East or in a majority Muslim country bring up a conflict or a lack of human rights, a lack of women's rights, etc., they always conclude a complete lack of connection to the religion. Do you think this is doing more harm? How much of a connection do you see with these problems towards religion?
Oh, I think it should be a sort of connection. I mean, you cannot say that this is absolutely not in Islam that women are not equal to men. As you know, the Sharia law, which is really something that it is obvious inside it, that the women are not equal to men. But the thing is, that doesn't mean that the people should change the religion. Religion is something very private between a person and his God. It can be all sort of religion. It is acceptable. But the way that if they come and say, in the 21st century, we should live in the way that this religion dictated, this is wrong. This is where we get the conflict with the human rights, because, as you know, 1,400 years ago, or thousands years ago, the way that the people looked at the human rights and the daily life, it was not the same as we do it in 21st century. Even I have heard that the Islam is a very feminist religion. You can hear all sorts of things that they are talking about, exaggerating about what it is not right. But you cannot have a modern argue as feminism in something which is thousands of years ago. They didn't believe in the equality and say, yeah, this is not the fault of the religion, or this is the interpretation of the religion. What I'm thinking is that this is a book, is written years ago. So just close it and go forward for making the world together. We decide what we want to do and close that book. If you want to have a religion, you are welcome to have whatever you want, but just keep it private and don't discriminate a person, other person, other gender, other beliefs with those sort of thoughts and ideology. That's the thing that we should ask in to find nowadays, because, as you know, we are very from a lots of origins, a lots of beliefs, and we can be so beautifully beside each other if we decide to make the lines of respect for human rights and respect for equality of every citizen very obviously, and we can solve our problems if we debate it and if we look at it critically in place of saying it is not at all something religion. I think the problems that we're facing nowadays, like inequality between men and women, this is inside that religion. And just we should discuss it and solve the problems.
If very few of your videos are in English. And so there's not enough information out there from you in English. So I was very excited to have you on my podcast to disseminate more your message to everyone. So for closing, is there any general message you'd like to say to an English-speaking audience?
I thank you for your time and interest. And I just wanted to add something very optimistic and for closing our discussion. And this is that we should really care about the equality, and we should search that equality and find it out in any kind of thoughts, religion, cultures. We should never say that, oh yeah, this is the culture of that sort of people, respect it. We just respect one thing, and this is we are all equal, from all the races, all the colors of skin, all the sort of genders, all the religion, and all the sort of languages that we can talk, we are equal. I hope one day we will see the beauty of being equal together in the whole world.
Thank you so much, Daria Safai, for being on my podcast. Where can people find you?
Oh, they can find me on my Facebook. I have a Facebook in Dutch. I have on Twitter that most of the time I put the things in English. So it's free for sending the messages. I have opened the option for everyone. And yeah, they can find me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. I think it's not easy. It's not difficult to search.
Well, I will have your links to your social media in the description of this, either SoundCloud or YouTube or wherever people are listening to it. And thank you so much again for coming on.
You are very welcome. Thank you.